Welcome to School Talk. I'm Nadjia Varney, your host. When most people hear the words education reform, no child left behind, they usually think of high standards, tests, and accountability. Well, today we're talking about the most important element for success in education, and that is the highly qualified teacher. However, controversy swirls around how do you define that? Who is the highly qualified teacher? And I'm delighted today to welcome to the set of School Talk Dr. Anna Bradfield. Dr. Bradfield was a teacher, and she has taught teachers, and she is the administrator here at Bridgewater State College of the Department of Education and Allied Studies. So it's my joy to welcome Dr. Anna Bradfield. Welcome, Dr. Bradfield.
Thank you, Nadjia.
Well, it's such a joy to have somebody that's, you've been through the trenches at all levels. But we're talking today about highly qualified teachers. But before we talk about that topic, I'd like to know personally how my guests get where they are. What brought you into the world of education?
I was influenced by my grandmother, who was a teacher from the time she was 17. And then when I was in school myself, I often found myself doing peer tutoring, being asked by my teachers to work with other students, and I really liked that. So when it came time to make a choice of career, I felt that was the best place for me.
And you've stayed with it, amazingly, because there aren't that many career steps in education. Teachers don't have many places to go other than into administration. So I'm grateful that a real teacher is an administrator. Right now, there is a great focus on the professional. We've heard so much about the testing and so forth. So I'm going to put to you, for your opinion, you've been reading it and living it, has this national emphasis on the highly qualified teacher, has it been helpful?
I think that there are two sides to that story. Anything that brings attention to our educational system and to our teachers that increases the standing and helps people understand how much work they do to become teachers is a good thing. So when you put a label on a teacher of highly qualified, I think that is a good thing because it sends the right message to parents, to children, and to the public. The phrase highly qualified teacher really came to the forefront as a part of the No Child Left Behind legislation. And actually, in that legislation, and through the state standards in each state, what a highly qualified teacher is actually fairly clear. A highly qualified teacher must have, there's several routes to do that. Number one, they can be highly qualified if they've passed their state teacher test or if they have a degree in the content area that they're teaching. So those are the two things that are sort of the standards for highly qualified.
Well, those things do sound like positive effects and consequences from the national focus. Are there any downsides or any negatives that you've been hearing or problems with it?
I think sometimes there are districts who, say for instance, rural districts sometimes really struggle because they may have just a few number of students and they have a teacher who needs to teach multiple subjects. And so there is sometimes a struggle regarding making sure that those teachers are qualified for the multiple subjects they teach. And that has been a struggle for districts and I think a downside. The other thing is that this particular legislation puts so much emphasis on the state teacher test as a measure of qualification of teaching. And I think, as we all know, in many cases that state teacher test teaches only content knowledge and does not necessarily test the ability of the teacher to perform in the classroom.
That leads me to ask, you did mention several things like the teacher test, the state test, and so forth. But how are they evaluated? Does somebody have to do, just somebody that can memorize and write papers well? Is that how they're evaluated, as you say, or are there any other things that they look at besides just their tests and their coursework? And in those two areas, do they have to be very proficient in them? Because, we're often reminded that we don't always get the best and brightest, for many other reasons probably, that go into business or law or whatever. But are the standards getting harder for people to get into teaching who would die to be a teacher? How do you evaluate this highly qualified teacher?
there's sort of two stages of evaluation, Nadjia. The first is how we evaluate them to let them enter teaching.
Okay.
So to get that first initial teacher's license.
Does that come from the college? Excuse me.
Well, it comes from, in almost every state in the United States, it comes from the fact that the Department of Education in that state has evaluated the program of the college or whomever is offering the program and said, yes, your program is approved, and then that gives us the right to recommend our candidates, our graduates for licensure. So we judge them on the basis of those standards, that whether they pass the test, and there's usually just a pass rate. It's not above or beyond or below. In Massachusetts, we also have, which I think is a good thing, although we've struggled with it, we also have an evaluation of that initial teacher that's done during their student teaching called the pre-service performance assessment, and that's another assessment that evaluates their ability to teach.
Mm-hmm. That sounds very good, the part of observing in their student teaching setting. Mm-hmm. Of course, that depends on what the teacher, their mentor teacher, gives them to do, if they're just running off copies or if they're actually given a chance to teach. Mm-hmm. So they are kind of at the mercy a little bit of the school that they go into, I know that. But now you are in charge of the Department of Education and Allied Studies, and I'm wondering how all these new mandates and demands on teachers, how is that affecting the pre-service education? What's going on? You know, years ago there was normal school where you went just for a couple of years and splashed out. So how is it affecting the pre-service, the teacher's training or education?
Well, of course, when the whole process of educational reform started, which, you know, is going to be close to 20 years ago now in many states, I think there needed to be an evaluation and an upgrade of the types of skills. But what that has meant for us is that there is a much more of our time is spent on assuring that all our teachers have appropriate content knowledge. So that when students come out of our programs, we know they know their content. They know their mathematics, they know their English, okay? In addition to that, it has, as time has gone on, it's also had us look very carefully at the other kinds of pedagogical knowledge that we're giving our students. Are they using scientifically rigorous methods that have been proven to work? And that's actually part of the No Child Left Behind. Mm-hmm. So we focus on that. In addition to that, I think there's been a number of demands for us to modify and update our curriculum to make sure that the teachers we prepare can work with all children.
Ah.
So children who have special needs.
Uh-huh.
Children for whom English is a second language. So those are the kinds of things that that this reform has brought about.
Well, those are very important points, it seems to me, because I remember years ago, many of the children with special needs were just told to go home.
That's right.
There was nobody to deal with them.
Right.
And then those who were brought into the school were up in a corner. I know when I first went to teaching, they were in this room all by themselves with their own little cooking and sewing.
Right.
And we've come a long way, and that's part of your preparation.
That's right.
In fact, I interviewed recently Dr. Lisa Battaglino,
right,
a star on your staff, I would say, and she was talking about how important it was for regular ed teachers to be aware of problems like special needs.
That's right.
Now, you've mentioned several ways that the highly qualified teacher would be evaluated, and I was glad you mentioned what you're doing about looking at student teaching. However, you know, usually once you're out of the college, you're kind of on your own, and you get thrown into a classroom with all the problems. And so I'd like to read a commentary from Education Week by Dr. Robert Pianta. He's a professor of education and director of the Center for Advanced Study of Teaching and Learning, dean of Curry School of Education at the University of Virginia in Charlottesville. And he writes in Education Week here. He talks about this whole idea of having just the content being evaluated, which you mentioned, their course content, their tests, scores, and so forth. But he said, amid all the debate over definitions and procedures, however, no one, well, maybe few, has suggested that classroom visits to watch teachers teach, employing standardized assessments of good teaching, could be used to accomplish this objective. He says, In fact, some of them say whether teachers like kids and can improve the skills, those are important. But all those things are rather hard to measure. So I wonder if you could talk to that. How do we measure this intangible, not so easily measured quality of a highly qualified teacher?
Of course, we talked about pre-service teachers and what the sort of things they have to go through. I think in his article, he was speaking of teachers who are in service.
Yes, absolutely.
There has been a great deal of research done about the first 5 years of a teacher in the classroom and what he or she must develop during that 5 years to become a good and better teacher. We can use highly qualified in the larger sense rather than not just the legal sense. There is a lot more focus today in most school districts and in most classrooms for those new teachers on a mentoring program, an induction program, where they are paired with a skilled teacher who is given time, often financial reward, to be able to assist that new teacher to, in some cases, evaluate, but those evaluations are kept often between the two teachers, and to assist them to become better by visiting their classroom, making suggestions on different pedagogical styles. And that support for those new teachers is one evaluative method, but it's also one way of keeping teachers in the classroom. Mm-hmm. In addition to that, of course, each state or in sometimes each district has different means of evaluation that may be tied to a union contract or may be tied to a structure of pay raises. But the comment that he makes about good assessment of the performance of the teacher in the classroom is important. The issue is that we don't yet have just incredibly good tools other than that good observational skills. There's not a really good, valid, reliable measure that could be used consistently across the nation.
Mm-hmm. I'd like to talk more about that on the second part of our program. Okay. Right now we're going to go to a break, but there are lots of questions swirling around the teacher. And you know, it's like congressmen. People say, we hate Congress, but we love our congressmen.
That's right.
And when you talk to parents, they say, we love our teacher, but oh, what a terrible education system we have. So we need to talk more about this important point, the teacher. We'll be right back. This is important. You have teachers or you are a teacher. Stay with us. We'll be right back.
Big dreams and good grades aren't enough to get into college. There are actual steps you need to take. Finding someone who can help is the first and most important. For the next steps, go to knowhowtogo.org.
How you doing?
Hi.
Hi.
Have a nice day.
You too.
Thanks.
If only child abuse were this easy to recognize. If you even suspect abuse, call 1-800-4-A-CHILD. All calls are anonymous and confidential. Trust your instincts.
Dr. Bradfield, we've been talking about the highly qualified teacher and how sometimes difficult it is to measure what that means. But I'm concerned about schools, for example, in the inner city where there are great minorities and there's more poverty. Mm-hmm. And often there are many more students who have English as second language. Mm-hmm. I mean, one small town or city nearby had 60 different languages in it.
Right.
Now, how do we evaluate a highly qualified teacher who faces a classroom of students that diverse? And maybe they do have enough highly qualified teachers, but I'm going to have you speak to that, please.
In most states, there is a preparation program to work with children who are English language learners that most teachers are required to complete before they have a child in their classroom who is an ELL learner. So that would be the classroom teacher, and that is really the kinds of skills that they need to do to incorporate those children into the classroom. And it's pretty successful. I think one of the bigger issues, however, is the child themselves and when they're ready to be integrated into a classroom. You know, a child who comes into this country whose language is only their native language, Farsi or Spanish or whatever, needs a little time in order to be able to be integrated in. Both the preparation of the teacher and also how we assist those children is actually one of our biggest issues and actually crises in the field of education.
And perhaps assisting the parents. Wouldn't
Absolutely.
That be a part of the whole plan?
And there is usually laws that require the school district to produce materials in the native language of the parent.
That's helpful, too, I know. It is a big problem, though, because I think what I've read is that often those kinds of communities, very rural or inner city, a minority part, they're often the people who cannot attract the highly qualified teachers. It's much easier to go to a rich community which pays better and you don't have the problem. So we still have to rely on people's good hearts as well as their competence to go into these places.
Well, the other thing is that another sort of successful tact is to recruit people who are from the community to become teachers.
Yes.
Because they're committed to the community, they're committed to the culture, and they are familiar to the children.
Now, that's something I think Bridgewater State College has done very well, because they recruit a great many people from this whole area. Mm-hmm. And some places have pockets of people who speak Portuguese or Spanish, and I think that's wonderful. There aren't as many barriers for people to come in here and into community colleges as well. That's really great. I see a big problem right now with the way they're actually evaluating schools. They say they're evaluating students, but I just learned not long ago that they will test fourth graders, and then the next year they don't test to see where those children have made progress. They test the next fourth grade. Mm-hmm. And most teachers are more concerned about what progress those students are making. Mm-hmm. So now there are pros and cons coming out. The Commission on No Child Left Behind is suggesting to use analyses of the students' grades. Mm-hmm. Let's see how the students are doing, and that will determine whether the teacher is highly qualified. That makes me nervous.
Makes many teachers nervous. It's actually already happening in several states, in Tennessee, Louisiana to a certain extent. I have yet to meet a very competent, qualified teacher who minds having his or her abilities assessed, because they know they can teach. Mm-hmm. But there are so many variables that impact how well a student does on a test, a state test.
Yes.
You know, everything from as simple as did they have breakfast this morning to were they able to get a good night's sleep, what kind of situation did they come into the testing, how is their test anxiety, are they familiar with the test process?
How long have they been in the country?
That's exactly right. So if they can find a way to sort of co-vary or to look at those variables along with the test score, it might be more palatable. But just to take a single test score and not look at those variables is a very unfair way of judging teachers.
I had a college professor who said to me, now with the teacher test, if my students don't pass that test, it reflects on me. Mm-hmm. Now that's just exactly what's happening in the elementary or high school or secondary. Right. If the student is, but at college level, it seems to me we have such a variety of people coming, older students coming back, young ones out of high school. And if they happen to be lazy or maybe have to work two jobs and they don't do well on the test, that to me, that's a little shocking that the professor who gave his or her 100% is now responsible. When does the student ever take responsibility is my question. It seems like it's all on the academic, the teachers. But that's my little editorial here, which leads me into this next question, actually. And that I'd like you to speak about the remuneration, the pay. Now, Massachusetts and Rhode Island, compared to the rest of the country, is not doing as badly. I just read the new quality counts. Mm-hmm. And across the country, it said a teacher with equal qualifications as someone going into another profession makes 88 cents to their dollar. But Rhode Island and Massachusetts aren't as bad as most of the states. But I still think that that's a problem. If you could speak to the two things that I think are so important, and that is the remuneration for teachers and the respect for them.
Well, interestingly enough, even though the absolute salaries of our teachers in southern New England are higher, our cost of living is so much higher than it is. So, you know, you sort of lose the advantage because it costs so much more. Until the country and our population understand how important the role of the teacher is, because the two things that you mentioned are tied together. Until there is a respect for teaching, as there is in many other cultures, many of the Asian cultures, for instance, or even in the European cultures, where teachers are held in high esteem because there is an understanding of the importance of education of young children, I don't know that we're ever going to be able to fight the battle to the level that we should. Teachers should have a living wage. I think that they, oftentimes the general public assume, well, they have these shortened work hours and they don't work in the summers. That's not true.
No, that isn't true, because they are only paid for the days they work. I never even realized that when I went into teaching, that they just hold your pay so that they can use it for the city or town through the summer. And you can actually ask for your pay before the summer comes. People say, you get paid for the summer. No, they don't.
You get paid for the contracted number of days.
Yes.
And so I am involved in a committee, a council here in our state, where we've had a huge amount of discussions about how we raise the profile, the respect, and the pay for teachers. And it's a conundrum, you know?
Well, I hope that you will remember this show, because I think we need to speak to the public. We have so many things going on within the academic world, and the average Joe Blow doesn't have an opportunity to hear what we're talking about today. Mm-hmm. And I think the youth, because television and technology are all connected, this goes onto iPods and onto video streaming and onto satellite internet, this one show. So this is a way to reach many more people, and I thank you for giving me freely of your time and expertise.
Thank you for asking.
And this is what we need to be doing. I will hurry along because the time goes by. But another article in Education Week spoke about a possible change in the No Child Left Behind program again. And it would provide incentives for states to collaborate with colleges and with businesses, that three-pod there, state, college, and business, to set the standards and align them to the demands not only of the college, but also the workforce. And as I mentioned off camera, I have some cautions about that, because I don't really want the economy, the tail wagging the dog, in my opinion, but that's my little editorial. Can you speak to how that would happen, or is that a good idea?
Well, I think there is no doubt that we need to graduate students from high school and from college who are prepared to enter the work world. And that there is a responsibility. Part of that responsibility lies on the education system, not all of it. Part of it lies in the home and with the parents as well. And so in that part of our responsibility, no, it's not a bad thing. What becomes a bad thing is when that drives all of the education. One of the problems that we've had with No Child Left Behind is that there is so much focus on a very few subject areas.
Oh, that's true.
And so, for instance, one of the big criticisms is that physical education, which is not one of the focus areas for No Child Left Behind, has been sort of ignored, and because they're putting so much focus on these content areas that are outlined. And so one of the results that most people believe is that we have this huge increase in childhood obesity. The same sorts of things could happen if you have too much focus. You have to have enough, but not too much, because we do want to produce a well-rounded individual. No one would, I don't believe anybody would argue with the fact that a well-rounded individual, a good member of our society who is a good citizen, should also appreciate things like art and music, theater, be able to interact at those levels, as well as needingly to be good in math and science and English language arts.
I think we kind of lost that focus in recent times. In fact, I always wonder about why we've put so much focus on money. Every game show, everything is around money. That's my fear with education. If businesses that have large amounts of money will come in and, as you say, take over all of education. And these children and students are not widgets. They are individual complex beings. We have just about a minute left, so I wonder if there's any particular thing about the looking for highly qualified teachers that has been frustrating to you, or you could speak about an accomplishment, something that's going on that gives you great hope. Well, both if you can do it in 30, 40 seconds.
I think that my great hope continues to be, and my satisfaction in doing this work, is that even with all the constraints and the problems that we list, we still attract terrific people into teaching who become highly qualified, maybe because they're required, but also because it's what they want to do. And that's the biggest hope I have. My biggest frustration, to be quite honest with you, has to do with respect, has to do with finances and funding for teaching in schools. That has been a lifelong struggle, and we haven't solved it yet.
Yes. Well, thank you for helping us to solve it, because we're going out to the public and remind them of how important this is. Thank you so much, Dr. Bradfield.
Thank you.
In closing, in Education Week, another commentary, but this time by Dr. Peter Heibowitz, professor of education at the University of Iowa in Iowa City. He uses a medical metaphor. He says, before Congress enacts legislation, they should remember the Hippocratic Oath in medicine. First, do no harm. We speak so much about research, and he says, quote, a little humility about the powers of research in the face of the complexities of teaching and a greater appreciation for the powers of the teacher might go a long way to protect children from legislated harm. I think that's very bold, interesting, and it's, I call it challenging school talk.